In this video, I'm going to talk about vision and hearing, which are two sensory systems that are driven by interactions with waves. I'll first talk about some terms you need to know about waves and how those waves interact with your sensory systems. Then I'll move on and give details on parts of our visual and hearing systems. Because vision is driven by interactions between light waves and your eye, and hearing is driven by interactions between sound waves and your ear, it's important to understand some basic things about how waves work. Now, whether we're talking about light waves, sound waves, heck, even waves on the ocean, the terms I'm about to talk about all apply. The top of the wave is known as the crest, or sometimes it's called the peak. The low point between waves is known as the trough. If you were to imagine a line drawn directly at the midway point between the crest and trough, the distance between it and the top and bottom of the wave is referred to as the amplitude. So this wave has a higher amplitude than this wave. The distance from the crest of one wave to the crest of the next is known as the wavelength. So this type of wave has a longer wavelength than this one does. Frequency is the number of crests within a certain space and time. So this is a higher frequency wave pattern than this. These are important to know because the type of waves influence how we see and hear. When it comes to hearing, the higher the amplitude of the wave, the louder something sounds. And the higher the frequency, the higher the pitch. So someone talking in a baritone voice is producing sound waves that are lower frequency. Likewise, when it comes to vision, differences in the wavelength of the light entering our eyes helps us to see color, and amplitude is how we can determine the brightness of an object. Humans are only capable of seeing and hearing a small number of the many different types of light and sound waves that exist in nature. It's important to remember these parts of the waves because it will come up again when we talk about states of consciousness and the different types of brain waves that we produce while we're sleeping. An interesting thing to keep in mind when I talk about vision and hearing is that because we have two eyes and two ears, well, at least most of us do, that means that these light and sound waves don't actually affect both eyes and both ears at the same time and in the same way. When it comes to vision, this difference allows us to get a sense of depth perception. And with our ears, this difference allows us to generally understand what direction a sound is coming from. Although sound location is a little bit more difficult because sound waves can be distorted more easily than light waves. So we talked about the different parts of the waves. Now I want to talk about the actual anatomical parts of the visual and auditory systems. Let's start with the eyes. If we look at a cross-section of a human eye, we see that there are many different structures. When light waves enter the eye, the first structure that they meet is a transparent covering of the eye that serves as a barrier between the inner eye and the outside world. This structure is called the cornea. Light is focused in towards a small opening in the eye known as the pupil. This is that small dark circle at the center of a person's eye. The colored area around the pupil is known as the iris. The iris is important in determining the size of the pupil. In low light conditions, the iris relaxes and allows the pupil to get bigger or dilate in order to allow in more light. In bright light conditions, the iris tenses and makes the pupil get smaller or contract in order to allow in less light. As light enters the pupil, it passes through the lens, which is a curved transparent structure that serves to provide additional focus for the light entering the eye. Be very careful with this, by the way, because sometimes people confuse the cornea with the lens. Remember that the lens is actually located behind the pupil. This lens helps focus images onto an indentation located at the back of the eye known as the fovea. There is one fovea on each eye, and it is located on the retina. In both the retina and the fovea, there are specialized photoreceptor cells which react to the light waves that have entered the eye. For the retina, we call these photoreceptor cells rods. Rods work well in low light conditions and help us with general vision. The fovea contains another type of photoreceptor, which are known as cones. Cones work best in bright light conditions and are important for helping us to perceive color as well as to detect fine details in images. You see a lot of different information regarding the overall number of photoreceptor cells in a human eye. Probably the most frequent information I have seen is that there are about 6 million cones in the fovea and about 92 million rods in the retina. Of course, these are estimates, which is probably why you would see pretty widely differing numbers. But there certainly are many times more rods than cones. These photoreceptors join behind the eye and form a bundle known as the optic nerve. These optic nerves travel from behind our eyes to the back of our brains all the way back to the occipital lobe. From there, visual information gets processed and sent to other parts of the brain. What's interesting though is that the left eye's optic nerve connects to the right occipital lobe, and the right eye's optic nerve connects to the left occipital lobe. On their way to the occipital lobe, they cross one another in a structure called the optic chiasm, which is located just below the hypothalamus. I think that covers enough about vision so far, so let's move on and discuss hearing. Our auditory system is divided into three main parts: the outer, middle, and inner ear. The outer ear includes the visible part of your ear, also known as the pinna, as well as the ear canal and the tympanic membrane, or eardrum. Located behind the eardrum is the middle ear, which is composed mostly of three very tiny bones, which are actually the smallest bones in the human body. These bones are called the malleus, the incus, and the stapes. Together, they're usually referred to as the ossicles. They connect to the inner ear. The inner ear is really two separate parts that engage in different functions. The first part is known as the semicircular canals. These are semicircular canals, or tube-like structures, that are involved in balance, and I'll get back to that later. The other part of the inner ear is the cochlea, which looks kind of like a snail shell. The way hearing works is that sound is funneled into the auditory canal by our outer ear. It travels down the auditory canal and strikes the eardrum. This stimulates those tiny little bones in the middle ear, or the ossicles, to move. The last ossicle, the stapes, attaches to the cochlea through a tiny little structure called the oval window. As it moves, it interacts with fluid inside the cochlea. Basically, what happens is that the sound waves are turned into fluid waves within the cochlea. These fluid waves then pass down the length of the cochlea. Now, the cochlea is lined with specialized sensory receptors called hair cells. These hair cells interact with the waves and connect with neurons that allow us to process sounds. There are about 15,000 hair cells in each ear, and they process information slightly different depending on where they're located within the cochlea. But that's a little bit beyond the scope of this video, so I'm not going to go into that too much more. Now, I said that I would get back to those semicircular ducts I mentioned earlier. I like to think of the semicircular ducts as being kind of like a level that a carpenter may use to make sure that something is straight. So the premise with a level is that you have a little bit of air kept within a liquid. You can tell when something is straight when that little air bubble is balanced. Your vestibular system works very similar to this and occurs in the semicircular canals found in the inner ear. The vestibular system is what gives us a sense of balance. Now, the nerve cells that line the semicircular canals form into the vestibular nerve and joins with the nerve cells that branch off the cochlea, which are called the cochlear nerve. Together, the vestibular nerve and the cochlear nerve are known as the vestibulocochlear nerve. Wow, that's a mouthful. This nerve travels through the temporal lobe towards the pons and on to the cerebellum. I realize that I covered a lot of information in a pretty short video, but hopefully this helped to make things a little bit clearer for you on how these very important sensory systems work. If you enjoyed this video, please make sure to press the thumbs up icon below and give me a like. Also, be sure to subscribe to my channel to help me keep content like this going. Thanks for watching, everybody.